We went from speaking and sharing two or three times a week, traveling all around North America with times when we were home and sharing about the work in Kyrgyzstan, to nothing. And for a year and a half, we travel out to the dump every now and then, or we go and pick up groceries, but that's about it. And as far as sharing, that just came to a screeching halt. So I was excited for the opportunity to be back here today and sharing, until I realized, well, if you look on the screen behind me, there's no PowerPoint. And I don't know if I can preach without PowerPoint. You see, I have a learning disability. And that learning disability makes it so that I can't read if I'm distracted. And you guys are a little bit distracting. The tree back there that's starting to turn red, that's distracting. There's so many things that distract me. And I thought, without my PowerPoint to keep me on track, that it was going to be difficult. God gave me a scripture. Find it here. It says, therefore, to keep me from becoming conceited, I was given a thorn in my flesh, a messenger of Satan, to torment me. Three times I pleaded with the Lord to take it away from me, but he said, my grace is sufficient for you. My power is made perfect in your weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weakness, so that Christ's power may rest on me. Amen. That is why, for Christ's sake, I can delight in weakness, insults, hardships, persecutions, and difficulties. For when I am weak, he is strong.
Amen. That's right.
So the greater my weaknesses are, the stronger God is. And it says, now I can boast in the things that God does. We're often taught that it's not good to be prideful. It's not good to be boastful. But it's okay to be proud of the things that God's done. And it's okay to boast about what the Lord's done. And as I share some of the stories, you'll see just how evident it is that it's nothing we've done, but it's what God has done. So a recap for some that don't know us, Julie and I are missionaries in Central Asia in Kyrgyzstan. That's just north of Afghanistan and just west of China. And we're up in the Himalayan mountains. And there we work with focusing mainly on the orphans and the widows. So seniors and a lot of work with disabled. Those that have fallen through the cracks of society, we're there to work with them and help them out. In doing so, we have a farm that we operate. My son-in-law started a farm. My son-in-law was the director of Teen Challenge in Kyrgyzstan, and he worked with a lot of people that they brought in off the streets. And my daughter worked in the orphanages with kids that were starting to age out of the orphanages. And they decided that if they could maybe take the kids directly from the orphanage and put them into a Teen Challenge type farm, then that could just eliminate the whole process of on the street, the drugs and all the difficulties. They say that when a child leaves the orphanage, within 1 year, 80% of them will be either dead, in prison, or in prostitution. And if we can get those kids before that, we can make a difference in their lives. So they set up this farm. And the farm we've used sort of as the hub for the work that we do in Kyrgyzstan. So when we need teams to go and help when somebody's house is burned down, we can take the kids from the farm. When we need food, we can get it from the farm. When we take kids on outings out of the orphanages, we take them to the farm. So it's sort of become the central focal point of what we do. At the farm, we wanted to set up a sustainability or self-sustainability or self-reliance so that we aren't always relying on the West. So we developed a few different projects. We have fields that during the summertime we're now growing 1,500 pounds a day of produce can come off the fields. We set up a guest house, and then we got a mountain yurt, yurts in the mountain, and a ranch in the mountain. So we can take up to maybe 25 guests a night there. And we had bees. We had 15 hives of bees producing over 400 liters of honey a year. And between that, we could operate about 20% of our operating expenses from bees, about 60% of our operating expenses from the guest house, and then some from the fields as well. But as I start to share about the things that have happened there, remembering that when we are weak, God is strong. I think of a time in history, the story of Gideon and the Israelites and the battles that they went through. And there's one battle in particular with Gideon where they were going after the Midianites. Gideon had an army of 40,000 men. And they were preparing for this battle, and I guess they were looking and thinking, you know what, we can do this. See, they become self-reliant. And God spoke to Gideon one night. He said, you know what, if you do this, even though I'm there helping you and supporting you, there's a possibility that you're going to take credit for this yourself. Your guys are going to think this is something that you've done, not something that I've done. So here's what we're going to do. So Gideon went to the men and said, okay, everybody, if there's anybody that doesn't really want to be here, for whatever reason, maybe you're not feeling well, maybe you've got family issues, something to do, maybe you're just afraid, it's okay. You don't have to stay. Go home. There'll be no hard feelings. Just go. I only want the people here who really, really want to be here. 30,000 men left. Left them with an army of 10,000. Back on the farm, we were thinking, okay, we can do this. And God said, yeah, but here's the thing. On this farm you have, the kids that I'm going to send to the farm are going to be kids from an orphanage with disabilities. And that'll be the majority of who you have. So their thought process isn't going to always be clear. And just in case that's not enough, you're going to have twice as many kids as what you need. And you're going to pay them twice what they're worth. And then you're going to give away everything you produce. That's not a very good business plan.
That's right.
So we needed to rely on our business partner. Suddenly we weren't so self-reliant. But we could be self-sustaining. So we worked that guest house business more, and the bees, and tried to figure out ways of recouping that loss from everything that we were giving away. So we thought, okay, we can still do this. So then God spoke to Gideon and said, okay, you still have too many men. You can easily convince yourself that it's something you've done. There has to be no doubt. So here's what we're going to do. So they took the 10,000 men that were left and they went down to the water. And he said, have them drink. And watch. And every see which ones bend over and drink directly from the water. And which ones scoop the water up into their hands and drink from their hand. 300 of the men scooped up from their hand. And he says, those are the ones you need. Send the other 9,700 home. So it left Gideon with an army of 300. March the 8th, 2020, the world imploded. Our flights were canceled and shut down. We were stuck here. We were just weeks away from starting our next season on the farm with guests at the guest house and teams coming in. The teams looked after all our humanitarian aid work was done with funds from teams. We had just come through a really long, hard winter. We were behind the gun financially. And we were just thinking, okay, in another couple of weeks, the guest house will be open and we'll have an income starting again. As we were trying to be self-reliant, self-sufficient. So when things shut down, they put barricades up and blocked the streets and closed everything down. Flights were canceled in and out of Kyrgyzstan. We lost our tourist business in the guest house, which wiped out 60% of our income. The teams, we had six teams or seven teams planned, and they all had to cancel, which wiped out our humanitarian aid budget. See, we were down to that 300 men against this army. So God spoke to Gideon and said, okay, now take your 300 men and lay down your weapons. Now, the army he was going against, it says that their camels were like the sands of the sea, and the men, the fighters, were like locusts. It was a big army. And he had 300 men, and they put down their weapons. So they had to know that this was God. So in their left hand, they were to hold up a trumpet or a horn. And in their right, a vase, would have been probably a clay pot, with a torch inside, with fire inside. And he said, you're going to go and surround the camp of the enemy. And then on my command, you will sound your horns, yell at the top of your lungs, by the sword of God and the power, by the power of God and the sword of Gideon. And then break open your vases and let the light shine. And to me, that is a message for us here today. As we're heading in, we're in these difficult times, and it seems like the army and the forces ahead of us are insurmountable. But God says, lay down your weapons. Call out, proudly proclaiming the power of God, and let your light shine. So over the next few weeks, back at the farm, we gathered up what we had. We had just got in a shipment of honey, and we couldn't sell it anymore because the company from Japan that was buying it couldn't get in to get it. So we had honey. We had sheep up in the mountains, so we called them home. We had planted our fields the fall before, doing an experiment with spinach as a winter crop. And in March, all our fields had 2 feet of spinach growing in them. So we said, okay, here's what we'll do. We'll start by giving out honey and spinach. Both are excellent medicinal values. And we'll start butchering our animals. We can rebuild later. So we took what we had and we put it on the line. We had a little bit, we had a donation come in, actually from somebody in the church here. Right away sent some money, so we were able to buy some flour and rice. We started packing care packages to give people. We were going to let our light shine. We would share about the power of our God and let our light shine. So we started packing food hampers. We've done that quite a bit. We always put out, every month we send out 20 or 30 families that we bring food hampers to. And if teams from anybody that's been there has had a part of that. Well, in the next week, we packed and delivered over 400 food hampers. It's not what we did. In our weakness, God was strong. As we were giving out the 400 hampers, funds started coming in. See, I sat on the line here blasting the horn, and our team let their light shine. That's right. We had a fellow we work with there that contacted us. He said, I have an idea. We want to give out baked loaves of bread, put them in the store, so people that can't afford food and can't eat can come to the store and get a loaf of bread. And maybe some people in the village will bring bread to the store if they have it. And it's a way of the community helping each other. I thought, wow, this is cool. And look, really, how much bread can this guy bake? How many loaves? Like 3,000-4,000 loaves at tops? So I said, okay, tell you what we're going to do. We will sponsor the flour and the yeast that we can cover 3,000-4,000 loaves of bread. 2 weeks later, they let us know that they had hit 40,000 loaves of bread had been given out. And that continued to grow for the weeks that followed. We started getting contacted from agencies and other NGOs we work with whose funds had dried up and were in trouble, asking us if we could help them. So we started sending food hampers their way and helping them with food supplies. And still, the donations continued to come in, and we were continuing to reach those needs. By this time, we were up to about 2,500 food hampers that had been delivered. And then the fellow that we were doing the bread with contacted us and said, the hospital system has collapsed here. People are dying in the streets. The doctors are dying. The nurses are dying. The ambulance attendants, they're not accepting anybody in the hospitals. And we want to set up some field hospitals, two in particular in our community, in gymnasiums with 200 beds each. So we started helping them with purchasing things like oxygen ventilators and the concentrators, and helping with the medication. Now, medication to save somebody or give them a fighting chance, it's only about $10. But when you have 200 people in two hospitals that they're cycling through every week, that becomes really expensive. But it didn't matter, because as we blew the horn and let our light shine, God continued to pour out. Absolutely amazing. We then started contacting other agencies before they contacted us. Proactive ministry. We were able to go to people like the Babushkas Society that helps the seniors. We were able to go to the homeless shelters that thought that they were forgotten. One of the homeless shelters, they had 70 or 80 people on a regular basis. And then the next problem was that their neighbors were getting upset because there was 2,000 and 3,000 people coming for the food. Absolutely unprecedented times. An absolutely unprecedented budget that we never ever dreamed. And yet God had continued to continually, steadily pour out and meet those needs. Our tuitions and scholarship program, the schools still wanted tuitions paid. They moved to in-home schooling, which meant that the teachers didn't have access to computers and ways of getting online. So one of our workers worked with teachers and got some students, and they were doing training and support network for the teachers. And the kids didn't have any way of getting online, so we were helping to buy little smartphones so that they could access school from their smartphones. And the number of students through that way that we sponsored and work with went through the roof. We came time to plant our gardens in the spring, and things had been so tight for families that we came to the realization that they didn't have seeds to put in the ground. if they only had 10 pounds of seed potatoes and they didn't have any food in their house, they aren't going to bury it for another few months. They would eat them. And we were getting ready to plant our gardens on the farm. We plant about 10 acres. And we got the idea, how many families out there are not putting gardens in because they can't afford the seeds? So we did a little survey. We found that there was about 200 acres out there that was not being used. So we put together seed packages and distributed those to these 200 acre extra acres. Instead of 10 acres, we have 210 acres in seed. And each of the families, they took the seeds and they planted the seeds. And the seed, and it was at the understanding that the seeds that they grow was for their families, for them, and for their neighbors. And that would take the pressure off for those that were in need. So we think of our, so many of us have COVID times, we have gardens. And I've put in two or three little gardens around my house, maybe equaling about a quarter of an acre. And just think, to go from 10 acres to 210 acres. And as the COVID rages on, we're now taking the fruit off of these fields and producing. To top it off, though, we had problems in Kyrgyzstan. Right now there is a drought. Just one more thing, eh? And there's this massive drought and fields were drying up and going brittle. The bees in the mountains that we get 400 liters from our 15 hives, they went up and the bees have stopped producing. There's 120 or so hives in the area where we have ours, and they're in a goji berry patch 3 miles up into the mountains. And they started drawing the honey. The guy who has 70 hives, he got 40 liters of honey. Our friend who has 40 hives, he got 41 liters of honey. We have 15 hives, and we got 120 liters of honey. And they're all there, they're all together, yet ours so overproduced, so much so that the guy who has the 70 says to the guy who has the 40, he says, so, you think they're playing for their bees? By name? God continued to pour out. Now, we were selling honey, but we kept back normally, but we were looking to keep back about 100 liters of honey to distribute, and then the rest we would sell for our self-sufficiency. So God just took out the self-sufficiency, but left us with the honey that we were going to give out. So we continued to give it away. But if the band can make their way back up here. See, when we look back at that story, we see that the word says that when Gideon's army broke open their vases and let their light shine, the army was confused. So confused that they turned on each other and they started killing each other and they wiped themselves out. And I believe that as a church, if we can put our weapons down, call out about the strength and the power of our Lord, and let our light shine as believers, that when people look at us and look at the church, they don't see the squabbling and the fighting and the confusion that the enemy had, but they see the light of Christ shining through. And that's so important for us. You know, we face the same thing here. First, it was shut the church down, close the church, and then it was, okay, you're limited to this number of people in the field. And then it was, no more out in the field. Now you're going to be in your cars. And no more meeting at people's homes. You're down to 5 people total outside, only in your bubble. Yet as a church, if we stand strong, let our light shine, then the enemy will be confused. And that's, I believe, is what we're seeing and what we're going to continue to see if we just hold strong and not put our faith in ourselves and what we're doing, but just trust in God. He knows the plan. He's got it all worked out. Okay.
I'm gonna let it shine. This in my mind. I'm gonna let it shine. This in my mind. I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine. Let it shine. Let it shine.